There is a striking analogy between wars between nations and the class war, which of course is also a kind of warfare. And one of the things about war in general and revolution in particular that you will notice is that they're rare events in history. You don't get wars and revolutions every day, although lately it seems that there are wars every day, but that's another matter. Wars and revolutions are rare events in human history. And there are analogies, there are striking analogies. I was recently engaged in a polemic you might have seen on the webpage with this Brazilian anarchist. The anarchists, of course, deny the importance of leadership in revolution. Well, that would be the equivalent of denying the importance of good officers and generals in war. And yet, you see, anyone with the slightest knowledge of warfare will know that many times in history, a big army composed of very courageous soldiers, ready to fight, ready to give their life, ready to die in the cause, many times these armies have been defeated, heavily defeated, by a small army of disciplined soldiers led by efficient officers and good generals. It's almost a law that if you get the two confronting each other, it's the latter which will prevail. Warfare must be studied. It is a science. There's a science of warfare. War is a deadly serious business. It's the most serious business of any nation. It's a fight for existence. And therefore, you don't treat war in a light-minded fashion. You see, war is a special subject of study for the officers and the generals. In military academies, what do they study? What do these officers study in military academies? They study the science of war. And how do they study this? They study it. They study in detail the history of past wars. When I say past wars, I don't just mean the First World War and the Second World War. They study the wars of Napoleon. They study the wars of Julius Caesar. Oh, yes. Why did they do this? You think they do this for amusement? Oh, no. It's a deadly serious business. They study these wars in order to extract the lessons to prepare for the next war. That's the purpose of this. And the study of warfare, therefore, that's of fundamental importance. Leadership and good generals and a clear scientific understanding of the nature of warfare is fundamental. That's why, because there is a direct parallel, as I say, we must study revolution if we're serious. You don't treat revolution as the anarchists do in a frivolous way. Oh, you don't need to study revolution. It's not a science. You just attack the bourgeoisie and end of story. Well, no, not so, my friends. That's a highly irresponsible and rather stupid way of posing the question, what is a very serious question. Revolutions, you require leadership, the same as you require good generals in a war. And therefore, we have to study revolutions. The problem that we have, of course, again, that's analogous with warfare. Revolutions are rare events, and therefore, we have to study carefully study in detail all previous revolutions. You know, the Paris Commune, for example, Marx spent a lot of time studying the Paris Commune and produced some wonderful works, which laid the basis then for Lenin's State and Revolution, a work which you should all read thoroughly. Yes, but not only that, we should study, as Marx did, the great French Revolution of the 18th century. Some marvelous lessons can be learned. It's a wonderful thing. Funnily enough, the best book that Trotsky recommended on that, I think he's right, was written by an anarchist, precisely Kropotkin. If you can get hold of it, I recommend it. The Great French Revolution, a wonderful book. It's wonderful because it shows the role of the masses. That really gives you a sense of the role of the masses, which is generally ignored or underestimated in bourgeois by bourgeois historians. Not all of them. Georges Rude, for example, wrote a very interesting book called The Crowd in the French Revolution, which is very interesting. Shows the role of the masses in the French Revolution. And the English Revolution. Oh, yes. As far back as the 17th century. I'm preparing something on that now, but it won't see the light for a while yet. But Trotsky actually recommended, you know, to the English Marxists in 1925 in a marvelous book called Where is Britain Going? Which, again, you should all read that book. Very contemporary book. And he strongly urged the British communists must study the past of the British Revolutionary Movement. Oh, yes, there is such a thing. And particularly, he recommended a study of the Chartist movement of the first part of the 19th century. And yes, the Great English Revolution of the 17th century, Oliver Cromwell and so on. Fascinating study. And what's interesting, if you study all these revolutions, what you find, of course, there are differences, there are important differences. But what you will find, and it's an amazing thing, is how you see the same patterns emerge, exactly the same processes, or very similar processes emerging. Even some of the individuals are quite strikingly similar. That's a proof of historical materialism, if you like. That similar historical environments, if you like, will produce similar historical characters. For example, the kings and queens. You compare Charles I and his French wife with Louis XVI and his Austrian wife, the Austrian woman, as she was known by the masses who hated her, of course. And the German-English wife of Nicholas II. It's almost staggering, the similarities between these people. And it's not surprising because you deal with the same process of a decadent social regime and a decadent system which produces similar characters. Fascinating question in and of itself. So what I'm saying is that even in the study of revolutions as different as the English Revolution, the French Revolution and the Russian Revolution, you'll see very similar processes, which you will see as you study this in other sessions, not in this one. Because in this one we're dealing with somewhat of a different question. But here I go back to the question of theory, the importance of theory. Now Trotsky once said, perspectives is a science, but tactics is an art. It's not the same. In warfare, it's not the same. In warfare, a general enters into a battle with a battle plan. He tries to work out in advance all the possible variants to the best of his ability. But in the course of the battle, if he sticks to that plan, when the circumstances change, of course, he'd make a mess of things. Tactics must be flexible. Tactics are not determined by general theory. Tactics are determined by the conditions on the ground. You'll see that. You see Lenin's masterly handling and Trotsky's masterly handling of tactics in the 12 months of the Russian Revolution. Or less than 12 months, what am I doing? 9 months of the Russian Revolution. But I'm here referring more to the question of theory, of strategy, if you like. Now, the subject of today is this morning's session, is the theory of the permanent revolution. Now, this is an absolutely astonishing, brilliant, perspicacious, profound theory, worked out by a youngster, as young as you lot probably, or younger, 25 years of age. It's astonishing. Trotsky was 25 in 1904 when he first put forward this theory, and he was the only one that put this forward. He was the only one. This is an astonishing fact. Stalin has tried to deny it, but it's nonsense what they say. It's an actual fact that in 1905, the first Russian Revolution took place in 1905, the only person in the whole of the Russian Marxist movement that was prepared to say, and he predicted, that the Russian workers could come to power in a socialist revolution before the workers of Germany or France or Britain or Western Europe, the only person was Trotsky. Even Lenin did not have that position in 1905, as we shall see. But let's go by this theory of the permanent revolution, this wonderful theory, which I will explain, I hope, in the course of the session, was put forward by Trotsky. It was, in a way, it was an astonishingly new idea. Yes, but it was new in inverted commas. It wasn't really so new, because it had, like all of Trotsky's writings and all of Lenin's writings, it is rooted in a long tradition of Marxist theory. You know, I sometimes get a little bit irritated, to put it mildly, when I hear people, even some comrades of ours sometimes, they want to put forward new ideas. Let's have some new ideas, you know. You know, I'll tell you something, I have never been concerned about putting for new and original, one would like to think that it is possible, but so what? I'm not particularly interested in originality. I'm more interested in correctness, in putting forward the correct ideas. And I don't look for new ideas. By the way, an idea is not necessarily correct or good for the fact of being new. 100% of the ideas put forward by the bourgeois philosophers and the bourgeois ideologues and the petty bourgeois hangers-on, including some who call themselves Marxists, are rubbish. Absolute arrant rubbish. Furthermore, there's nothing new in them. I've looked at these ideas. I once had the misfortune of writing a very lengthy book answering by one of these idiots called a professor. Yes, most of them are professors, the biggest idiots in society. I wouldn't name any names. I debated with one recently. I think you know who I'm referring to. I better not cause offense. The biggest idiots are professors, for goodness sake. These are people who spout the ideas. And by the way, they represent the interests of the bourgeoisie. Absolutely 1,000%. I mean, look at this avalanche of books which have been produced now predictably about the Russian Revolution by so-called experts and so-called historians. Absolute horrible rubbish from start to finish. By the way, in the past, there were one or two decent bourgeois historians, like E.H. Carr. He's the former editor of the Times. At least the man made a serious effort to understand what Bolshevism was. It's not the latest crowd of reptiles that creep around the passages of universities and spew their vomit on a daily basis to only for one person, to confuse and to persuade the youngsters, the young generation, that revolution, you know, revolution does not pay. Stay away from revolution. Doesn't really pay, you know. Absolute rubbish, all these new ideas. By the way, there's nothing new about them. I know this. I've looked at them. You will find in every case it's just a repetition, in a worse way, of old distorted ideas of revisionist thinkers of the past, or utopian socialists of the past. That's all. Absolute nonsense, not worth even a glance, let alone a study. Yes, but Trotsky's idea of the permanent revolution was not like that. Before he went into print on that, he studied the writings of Marx and Engels, particularly the writings related to the German Revolution of 1848-1849. There was a wave of revolutions in Europe. You know, some people, I think it was even Donald Tusk, said about 12 months ago, he compared the present situation in Europe to the situation in 1848. That's quite interesting. Where there was a wave of revolution throughout Europe. The conditions are being prepared for that. Yes, but these revolutions ultimately were defeated, despite the heroism of the working class. They were defeated. And Marx and Engels studied carefully the reasons for the defeat. Now, let's be clear. The nature of the tasks of those revolutions, we're talking about the 1840s, these were, in effect, bourgeois democratic revolutions. The same as the French Revolution was objectively a bourgeois democratic revolution, or the English Revolution was a bourgeois democratic revolution. Yes, but you could argue, Marx and Engels thought or put forward the idea, that the bourgeoisie in the 18th century and in the 17th century in England played a revolutionary role in overthrowing what? In overthrowing the feudal system. The absolute monarchy, laying the basis for the development of capitalism, of democracy, and so on. What are the objective tasks of a bourgeois revolution? Well, first of all, it would be the overthrow of the old feudal regime, the complete liquidation of all the remnants of feudalism, the absolute monarchy, of course, the creation of a bourgeois republic, and of democracy, of bourgeois democracy, parliamentary democracy, the agrarian reform, the breakup of the big feudal estates and their substitution by, their replacement by free peasants, small peasant agriculture. And all of this would serve to prepare the way, if you like, for the modernization of society, for the development of new industry and of capitalism. And a modern bourgeois capitalist democracy. Those were the historic tasks of the bourgeois democratic revolution. They were carried out thoroughly in France, not quite so thoroughly in this country, although Cromwell was pretty thorough. He abolished the monarchy by a rapid procedure, you know. Painless procedure, at least it didn't hurt Cromwell very much anyway. He was quite, he was dancing for joy when he signed, you know that, he was dancing for joy when he signed the king's death warrant. Cracking jokes and flicking ink at the other people that were signing. That's an actual fact. So anyway, they carried this out quite thoroughly. They abolished the House of Lords and so on. Then, of course, the bourgeoisie, after Cromwell's death, invited the monarchy back. So if we, even to this day, you can say, we've not really thoroughly carried out the bourgeois democratic task, even in an advanced country like Britain, because of the rottenness of the British bourgeoisie, who compromised. Once Cromwell was out of the way, couldn't do it when he was alive. They compromised with the monarchy, with the aristocracy, if you like, and therefore we got these wretched remnants of feudalism. They call this country democratic. What's democratic about having an unelected head of state, who is only the head of state by virtue of the fact of birth, an accident of birth? Or the House of Lords, which these institutions have still got some power, by the way. Don't you believe they don't have any power? They do. It's not generally used, but it can be used in the future against a socialist government. That's another matter. What I'm saying is that it did serve as a basis for the spectacular development of capitalism and capitalist industry in Britain. That is undeniable. The French were more thorough. They went much further under the Jacobins, you know, with the aid of something, a device known as the National Razor. You know what the National Razor is? The guillotine. You know, they made a thorough job, a very thorough job of sorting out the aristocracy and the monarchy and so on. And that was a far more advanced thing. Yes, but by the time you reach 1848 in Germany and France, there was a different situation. I repeat, there are comparisons, yes, of course. There are also important differences. What's the important difference? Well, the important difference was that by 1848, you already had the development, a certain development of industry in France, even in Germany, that was the case. And you had the beginnings of the proletariat, the working class. Therefore, the German bourgeois in particular were terrified of opening up an all-out struggle against feudalism and against the monarchy for fear of the forces that they would unleash. They'd be constantly looking over their shoulders at the workers and so on. And therefore they behaved, the bourgeois liberals in Germany behaved in a cowardly, treacherous, and ultimately counter-revolutionary manner. And Marx and Engels, of course, drew the necessary conclusions. You read their writings, they're absolutely scathing in their pitiless criticism and denunciations of the liberals, the cowardice of the liberals, and the vacillations also of the petty bourgeois Democrats. And it was Marx, actually, that first advanced the slogan. I don't know if you know this. It was Marx that put forth the slogan of the permanent revolution. At the end of one of his writings on the German Revolution, he put, let our slogan be, the revolution in permanence. In permanence. By which he meant, no question now of any deals or blocks with the treacherous bourgeoisie, and that the workers must have an independent class policy. That the only revolution in Germany, that Marx came to that conclusion, was no longer the bourgeois democratic revolution, but the socialist revolution led by the German working class would have to carry out the tasks, the historical tasks of the bourgeois democratic revolution. Absolutely correct theory of Marx, which Trotsky then developed. Now, actually, if I might be permitted a personal take on this, the conclusion that I've come to, which you may or may not agree with, over many years looking into this, is as follows. As a matter of fact, the bourgeoisie never played a revolutionary role, even in France and in England. It isn't true. It's true they started the ball rolling with their conflicts with the king over taxation and things of this character, but no. Take the English Revolution. The English Revolution only succeeded when the masses, if you like, particularly I'm referring to the artisans, the London apprentices played a big role in this, the poor people, the men of no property, the women also, by the way, the women played a big role in both the English and the French Revolution. It's not generally known. And of course, in particular, the radicalized revolutionary petty bourgeoisie, the small farmers of East Anglia, like Cromwell himself, a small farmer, not a bourgeois, small farmer, is reflected in religion with the emergence of the independents, the so-called independents, the extreme Puritans, as opposed to the Presbyterians, the moderate Presbyterians in Parliament. These were political parties, in effect. I won't go into the details, it's a separate discussion. But even there, you see, it was only when Cromwell actually dispersed the Parliament. Oh, by the way, you see what they write about the Bolsheviks? They hold up their hands in holy horror. Look, the Bolsheviks dispersed, they dissolved the Constituent Assembly, they were against democracy. What about Cromwell? Didn't he dissolve Parliament? Of course he did. He dissolved the Parliament. Took troops along and said, that's enough. You've sat here long enough for any good that you might have done. Yes, wouldn't it be a good idea to do that now? Turns up with his revolutionary troops at his back and says, right, all girls and boys, or they were the only boys at the time, you've sat here for long enough for any good you might have, be gone. And as the Parliament, as the members of Parliament trooped through the door, he knew them all personally. He denounced them and scolded them. There goes an adulterer. There goes a drunkard. There goes, and so on and so forth, you know, as they went through the door. And he kicked them out of, they disappeared from the pages of history after that. And as Cromwell said, not a dog barked. Not a dog barked after I dissolved the Parliament. People were glad to see the back of them. You know, I think people would be today also, but that's another matter. The point I'm making is that the English Revolution only succeeded at that point when the bourgeois were kicked out, physically removed, because they were at that time they were striving for a deal and a compromise with the king. No question about it. French Revolution is even clearer. It was the masses of Paris, the semi-proletarian masses, if you like, the sans-culottes, as they were known. The poor semi-proletarians and plebeian elements of Paris, the women in particular played a role. Not these petty bourgeois women feminists in the university, with apologies, I don't care what people think about that, it's nonsense. These were the fishwives of the fish markets, the poor working class women, the kind you find in the Cockney in the East End of London, you know. Never been to university, probably most of them couldn't read or write, didn't make any difference. They wanted to change, they wanted to get rid of the monarchy, and by God, they actually shamed the men into following them, you know. They grabbed guns and cannons, they weren't messing around in university seminars talking about words, you know, what words and political correctness. They were interested in guns, cannons, pikes, which they grabbed, marched on Versailles, and shamed the men into following them. It's an actual fact. That's how to fight for women's emancipation and the emancipation of society. But to go back, the French bourgeoisie were elbowed to one side and replaced by the Jacobins, who represented what? The revolutionary petty bourgeoisie, who were prepared to lean on the masses. They weren't prepared to allow the masses to have power, same as Cromwell was not prepared to allow the levellers to have power, but they leaned on them and mobilized them against the old regime. Anyway, you will forgive me for this little historical digression. That's a subject which we can discuss. But my argument is that the bourgeoisie really has never played a revolutionary role, actually. But certainly in 1848, that was the case. Now, what about Russia? Well, look, what Russia are we talking about here? What Russia are we talking about? Tsarist Russia, and people forget this, Tsarist Russia before 1917 was a backward country. Some of these bourgeois nitwits today tried to deny this. I don't know, they must have their head up their ass or someplace. Anyway, I prefer not to discuss these gentlemen. Makes me angry. Tsarist Russia was an extremely backward country. It was more backward, actually, than India or even Pakistan is at the present time. You can quantify that quite easily. How many industrial workers were there in Russia in 1917? Well, we're talking about industrial workers, less than 4 million, 3.5 million industrial workers in a population of 150 million. Even if you include the broadest categories of workers, railway workers, mines and so on and so forth, even there you wouldn't come to more than 10 million. Think of it, just think. 10 million workers in a country of 150 million peasants. And although it is true that out of fear of revolution, the Tsar of Russia, Alexander II, wasn't it? I think, the Tsar of Russia did carry out a reform, some reform, by the way, which saddled the peasants with huge debts, didn't solve anything. But he did formally abolish serfdom. Serfdom was the feudal agricultural system. The serfs were abolished. So legally, the peasants were free. They were no longer bound to serve the landlords as they used to be, almost like slaves, tied to the land. And they could move around, which was important from the standpoint of the development of capitalism. But you see, but nevertheless, they were forced to pay. First of all, they weren't given all the land, and the land that they were given was the worst land. The best land remained in the hands of the landlords, and they had to pay for this land, which led to colossal debts, which, by the way, I think they wouldn't have paid them off until now, thereabouts. That had been saddled with it eternally with this colossal debt. So that solved nothing. Yes, but it did assist the development of capitalism in Russia. That's true. That is perfectly true. And there was a big development of capitalism, actually, in the 1880s and the 1890s. As a result of a huge influx of foreign capital. It reminds me of China. There we are, Daniel. It's similar to China in many ways. Huge influx of foreign capital, foreign investment, which enabled the construction of factories, foreign-owned factories in the main, by the way. They were mainly foreign-owned, not all of them. In the west of Russia, in what is now Poland and the Baltic states and the western parts of Russia, to some extent in other parts like, of course, Moscow, St. Petersburg, the area around St. Petersburg, parts of the rest of the country, the Urals, for example, because of the coal and other minerals, and the Caucasus, for the same reason, oil, Baku and so on. There was a certain development of industry. And of course, what you have here, and Lenin explained this, it's different from Marx's day. By the way, if I might be permitted to go back a little bit, it's often thrown in our face by ignoramuses. Surprising how many ignoramuses there are around. I don't know. Where do these people come from? The universities, no doubt. They're expert at producing ignoramuses. Anyway, so Marx said, and it's true, he did say this, that the Socialist Revolution, the Workers' Revolution, would begin in France. He said this. He said it would begin in France, it would be continued in Germany, and be finished in England. That's what he said. He had reasons for saying that, because of the revolutionary traditions of the French workers, which go back a long way. But it would happen, you see, at that time, when he wrote that, which would have been about 1850, thereabouts, I can't remember the precise date, at that time, the working class, and of course socialism must be based on the working class and on industry, that goes without saying, only existed in these countries. To a very limited extent, it existed to a small extent in Belgium and in Holland, and the United States was beginning to develop. But basically in Europe, you were talking about those three countries. So he said, well, we'll start with France, be continued in Germany, be finished in England. Why in England? Because England was that country where the capitalist production and industry was more highly developed. And let's not forget this. Socialism requires a material basis. It requires a certain development of the means of production. That's absolutely ABC. Why didn't he mention Russia? He didn't mention Russia. By the way, it isn't that Marx and Engels ignored Russia or ignored the revolutionary potential of Russia, which did exist. I'll deal with that in a moment. They had contacts with the Russian revolutionaries. But there was no working class in Russia at that time when they wrote that. And therefore, from the standpoint of a socialist revolution, that was definitely out of the question. The revolutionary movement that did exist at that time was mainly among the students, actually. the Narodniks and the Narodnaya Volya movement, the People's Will movement, which bases itself on terrorism and the idea of a peasant revolution, the workers didn't really enter into their field of vision, actually, although they were very courageous young men and women, extremely courageous. Lenin's brother, actually, Alexander, was a member of the Narodna Volya, who was executed for an attempt on the life of the Tsar. He was executed. But they weren't Marxists, although they were friendly towards, they had friendly relations with Karl Marx. Yes. And Marx and Engels had relations with them. They corresponded with them, were quite sympathetic and so on. But we're not talking here about the socialist revolution in Russia. Now, you see, all that changed, as I've said, in the two decades of the 1880s and 1890s, with this explosive development of capitalism in parts of Russia. The opening up of factories, mainly foreign-owned factories, very similar to China, as I say. And as with China today, as with China, the bourgeoisie, when the American and the German and the Belgian and the French bourgeois that invested in these factories, they didn't go back and set up. They didn't have to go back to the 17th century and start with windmills and water mills and handicrafts. Oh, no. They were able to set up the most modern factories in Russia with the most modern technology. Big factories with modern machines. And as Trotsky explains, and it's quite true, these peasants, the Russian peasants, they now were in a difficult position precisely as a result of the emancipation of the serfs. Many of them flocked to the towns, because what that meant was that it was the rich peasants that could get hold of the land, buy the land. The poor peasants, the landless peasants, had no alternative but to flee to the cities and look for work in the factories, where, to quote Trotsky's expression, the Russian peasants were thrown into the seething cauldron of factory life. Now, if you know anything about the peasant mentality is a very conservative mentality. It's based on routine. Of course, there's a lot of ignorance, no education, these people were illiterate and so on. Heavily under the influence of the church. Actually, many of them were monarchists, supported the monarchy. They believed that the Tsar would protect them, the little father, the Batyushka, would protect them against the landlords. That's what they thought. But of course, once they were thrown into the factories, then they very quickly became proletarianized. And from being extremely backward conservative peasants, they became very revolutionary workers, a fresh young working class with no tradition. That's the difference with Britain, by the way. It's not the same with Britain. The task of the Russian Marxists is not at all the same. In Britain, we have a country with a long bourgeois democratic past, with the legal trade unions and a Labour Party, a reformist Labour Party. The traditions of reformism weigh heavily on the consciousness of the British workers. And of course, it will take time and experience. That's now breaking down, and it will break down. Under the hammer blows of the crisis of capitalism, those prejudices will break down. And the revolutionary ideas will penetrate the mentality of the British workers. It started already, if you're able to read the symptoms, as it is in America and France, if you're able to read the symptoms. But in Russia, if you like, the task of the Russian Marxists was easier. It was more difficult because, of course, they were underground, they were illegal. No rights, no freedom of speech, no freedom to organize, all underground, facing heavy police repression and vicious sentences and even risking their lives, risking torture, imprisonment, flogging and so on. Oh, yes. Yes, but on the other hand, particularly in the 1890s, you had this vista opening up of a revolutionary working class, the beginnings of a colossal strike wave. Imagine it, no legal trade unions, no right to strike, and yet there were massive strikes taking place all the time on economic issues to begin with. But under those conditions, the economic strikes very rapidly acquired a political character, which opened the door wide open to the development of Russian Marxism. There was an ideological battle between the Marxists and the old Narodniks, who still clung to this idea that the peasantry is a revolution, as the main revolutionary force. Eventually, the Marxists succeeded. You had the foundation of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party. The Second Congress, which was really the founding Congress, took place here in London in 1903, where, as you know, there was a split between the faction led by Lenin, which were known at the time as the hard faction, the hardliners, and the softs, as they were known, Alan Martov. Now, you know, we know about splits. We've experienced splits in our own movement. We're not worried about that. Splits are part of the development of the revolutionary movement. It's part of it. Same as crises are part of life. You know, birth is a crisis, a painful crisis. Adolescence is a crisis. And as I'm beginning to find out, old age also has got its fair share of problems, also some benefits. But now, we leave that to one side. You will experience the joys of this in the future, possibly. But in any case, to come back to what I was saying, crises in the it's a fact of life. It reflects a certain conservative element which always exists, which comes into conflict with the needs of a changed situation. But I won't go into that because it's not the subject of today's discussion. Just to say this, sometimes people say to me, "Ah, yes, there's a split, but where's the political basis?" I'm tired of hearing this. Where's the political basis? Of course, in the last analysis, there's always, there must be some kind of a political basis. Yes, but if you ask yourself, what was the political basis of the split in 1903 between Lenin and Martov? I answer, there was apparently none. Yes. You look at all the political sessions, they were in complete agreement. The split came apparently on accidental questions of an organizational character. Who's a member and who's not a member? Quite an important question. But also, particularly, the composition of the editorial board. Now, I won't go into all this, because actually these were accidental elements. Nevertheless, what you could argue, quite correctly, is that in this split there was implicitly a difference, a political difference. Not clear, it was embryonic. It was not clear to Lenin, that's why after the split he had a nervous breakdown, actually. I had to go to the Alps to recover. He was shocked by it, he wasn't expecting it. Martov was a personal friend and a comrade of his, of several years. So even Lenin wasn't clear on that. But of course Trotsky was confused. He supported Martov during the split, but he separated from Martov and the Mensheviks when they became the Mensheviks. Yes, there was an implicit difference. It's implicit even this terminology, the hards and the softs, it's implicit. Or this question of who's a member and who's not a member. Because the argument of Martov wanted to blur the difference between a member and a sympathizer. And the fact of the matter was, at that stage, there was a layer of bourgeois intellectuals, university professors, my friends, how I love them, university who pretended to be Marxists. Oh, doesn't this sound up to date, Adam? They pretended to be Marxists. They called themselves Marxists. They had nothing to do with Marxism. They were academic Marxists. You know, I detest that phrase. There is no such thing, there cannot be such a thing as an academic Marxist. Marxism is revolutionary. It's not a seminar thing for squabbling over this or that obscure formula. That's not Marxism. Good. That's university dilettantism of the worst sort. You get these creatures now calling themselves academic Marxists. God preserve us from academic Marxists, I say. And they were called the legal Marxists. Why legal? Because this is all illegal stuff. But there were always some legal possibilities, as long as you didn't talk too clearly. For example, Capital, the Communist Manifesto was banned. This was true in Spain when I was engaged in illegal work years ago, under the Franco dictatorship. Communist Manifesto was banned, but Capital was allowed. Why? Because the censor was too thick to understand. You say, well, nobody can understand this, or let them discuss this or this rubbish all they want. So there was a margin there which these legal distorters of Marxism, that's what they were, used. And what Martov wanted, and the other Mensheviks, the softs, was, well, let's not be too unkind to these people. We need them. Let's be friends. And why can't they be members? All right, maybe they can never turn up to a meeting. Maybe they won't pay subs or something. That's all right, because they're still friends of ours, you know. We need the bourgeoisie. That's the argument. We need the bourgeois liberals. That's the Struve, by the way, Peter Struve, Piotr Struve, the leading legal Marxists, who was formerly a social democrat, later became one of the main leaders of the Russian bourgeois liberals opposed to the October Revolution. Not an accident. Not an accident. Anyway, what the point I wanted to make is this. After the split, political differences began to emerge. And I would argue that they were always implicit. But now they became explicit. Immediately after, in 1904, the Mensheviks, there was a campaign, banqueting campaign it was known. You know, there was a campaign of banquets, of public banquets, organized by the liberals as a means of opposing the regime. Lenin was opposed to these banquets. He recommended the workers should go and break them up, actually. And here the difference emerged between the two main tendencies in the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party, political tendencies. And it was on this question of the liberals. The Mensheviks argued as follows. What is the objective character of the Russian Revolution today? They answered, it is a bourgeois democratic revolution. Was that wrong? No. No, no. That was absolutely correct. The objective immediate tasks of the Russian Revolution were what? Not the introduction of socialism. The immediate task was the overthrow of the monarchy, the introduction of a bourgeois republic, and land to the peasants. Those were the main things, plus the solution of the national problem and things of this character. Those were the fundamental, immediate tasks. But then the Mensheviks went further. That being the case, the working class must not take power in Russia, cannot take power, must not take power. Power must be handed over to the liberal bourgeoisie. On that question, Lenin fundamentally disagreed. Following Marx in 1848, he explained, if the German bourgeois betrayed because they were frightened of the workers in 1848, 100 times more the Russian bourgeois liberals will betray because of the strength of the Russian proletariat. Although it was small, the Russian proletariat had considerable strength. And therefore, Lenin asked, because he said, well, yes, it's a bourgeois democrat. No, nobody disagreed on this, except for Trotsky. But anyway, no, but even Trotsky agreed that objectively the revolution was bourgeois democratic. Yes, but Lenin said that the bourgeois liberals will betray, have no confidence, no faith in, no trust in them, break with them, no class collaboration. And then he asked an interesting question. The answer is here. By the way, I recommend this book. It's by a young and promising author. Well, by two authors, and one of them is not around at the present time. Called Lenin and Trotsky, What They Really Stood For. You find all the necessary quotes here, which you can check if you wish. Here's one of them. This is what Lenin wrote. He says, well, you can't trust the bourgeois. They're counter-revolutionary. He was always emphatic on that. He writes the following. There remains the people. That is the proletariat and the peasantry. That's perfectly clear, isn't it? Perfectly clear. The people, the only people we can trust is the workers and peasants. The proletariat, and then he continues, the proletariat alone can be relied upon to march to the end. Okay? For it goes beyond the democratic revolution. That is why the proletariat fight in the forefront for a republic and contemptuously rejects stupid and unworthy advice to take into account the possibility of the bourgeoisie recoiling. In other words, oh, you mustn't go too far. You'll upset the bourgeois liberals. This argument, which Lenin regards as treated with contempt. He said it was a contemptible argument. We base ourselves on the workers and peasants. Yes, but be careful. Lenin was careful. You see what he says here. He's not referring to a socialist revolution. He says the workers and peasants are the only revolutionary forces to carry out what? To carry out the tasks of the bourgeois democratic revolution. That's all. What about the conception of socialism? Is it possible? He actually says here somewhere else. But of course, says Lenin, it will be a democratic, not a socialist dictatorship. The slogan he put forward at that time, this is about 1905, 1906, was for the democratic dictatorship of the proletariat and peasantry. That was Lenin's slogan, which, when compared to the Menshevik position of collaboration with the bourgeois, was progressive. Trotsky considered that to be a step forward and progressive. But Trotsky said it didn't go far enough. It didn't go far enough. But before I proceed to Trotsky's position, what was Lenin's attitude about the prospect for socialism? He made that, as Marx did, he made that dependent on the victory, the prior victory of socialism in the rest of Europe. Let me quote one thing which makes it clear. Thus, at this stage, that's to say, after the victory of the democratic dictatorship of the proletarian peasantry, the liberal bourgeoisie and the well-to-do peasantry, plus partly the middle peasantry, organized the counter-revolution. That occurred in Russia, of course, in 1918. The Russian proletariat plus, listen to this, the Russian proletariat plus the European proletariat organized revolution. In such conditions, the Russian proletariat can win a second victory. The cause is no longer hopeless. The second victory will be the socialist revolution in Europe. The European workers will then show us how to do it. Get that straight. The European workers will show us how it's done. And then together with them, we shall bring about the socialist revolution. Now, I think that's fairly clear. And that was the position of Lenin right up to 1917. In other words, he made he said that the Russian workers and peasants must carry through the revolution against the liberals, against the bourgeoisie. But of course, we can only make the revolution a socialist revolution if the German and French workers take power first. That was Lenin's. Now, Trotsky disagreed with Lenin on this question. Although he considered Lenin's position was far superior, which it was, to the Mensheviks, he criticized the formula democratic dictatorship of the proletarian peasantry as ambiguous and contradictory, which it was, frankly. What was Trotsky's argument? He argued this. He said, look, the bourgeoisie in Russia cannot play a revolutionary role in its own revolution for the following reasons. First of all, it is tied with 1,000 links to the feudal landowning class. That is to say, manufacturers, industrialists, held land, bought estates, and landlords also bought industries. There was a link through the banks in particular. Okay, so there's one reactionary block, if you like. Therefore, how can the bourgeoisie carry out an agrarian revolution, that was one of the fundamental tasks, if it's linked to the landowning class? It can't do that. Apart from the fact that any move against the property of the landlords is dangerous because it presents a threat to private property as such, okay? Point number one. Point number two, the weak, senile, degenerate Russian bourgeoisie is linked by 1,000 links to foreign capital. It's dependent on British, Belgian, German, French, American capital. And therefore it can't free itself. You saw that during the war. You think of the slogans of Lenin in 1917, peace, bread and land, which the bourgeois provisional government could not grant. They couldn't do this. They couldn't grant peace above all because they were tied, completely tied to the money, to the strings of the bankers of France and Britain. And therefore they couldn't end the war. They couldn't give land to the peasants because they were linked to the landlord class. And therefore, in order to carry out the task of the bourgeois democratic revolution, it was necessary to kick the bourgeois out, to overthrow the provisional government, and for the workers to take power. Lenin and Trotsky were in agreement on this, but Trotsky went further. He said, now look, if the Russian working class is going to take, by the way, he said, you can't talk about a dictatorship of the proletarian peasantry. The peasantry cannot play an independent role. It never has. And never will, because of its amorphous character. The peasantry are they're not organized, they're amorphous, they split up into a host of private small plots. With, as Marx said, with no more connection than potatoes in a sack, Marx once said. And therefore, the peasantry, even where it plays a revolutionary role, ultimately the future is not determined by the countryside, but by the towns, by the cities. And the peasantry will either support the bourgeoisie or the working class. And therefore, Trotsky's argument is that the working class, the proletariat, must place itself at the head of the revolution. If you like, the proletariat must place itself at the head of the nation. Yes, but Trotsky went further. He said, now look, concretely, if the Russian workers make all the sacrifices and all the effort of taking power, you think they're going to stop at the boundaries of the bourgeois revolution? You think they'll just be satisfied by the bourgeois republic and a few reforms and taking over the peasants, taking over the land? They will not be satisfied. They'll be faced with a counter-revolutionary bourgeoisie. They'll have to take action against the bourgeoisie, and therefore immediately they'll be faced with the tasks of the socialist revolution, of expropriation of the capitalists. And therefore that would be the beginning. Does this mean to say that you can have socialism in Russia before the West? Be careful. You can have a socialist revolution in Russia before the West, is what Trotsky predicted. And that's what actually occurred in 1917. But of course, Trotsky agreed with Lenin. The conditions for socialism were absent in Russia. And therefore, the Russian Revolution must only be the first stage for the European Revolution. And then you could have, as Lenin pointed out, then you could have, on the basis of a socialist federation of Russia and Germany, for example, you could have the basis for developing socialism in Russia. That's Trotsky's theory of the permanent revolution. So if you think about it, it's got two elements. The theory of the permanent revolution has got two elements. First of all, although the objective character of the revolution, not just in Russia, by the way, the importance of this theory is it's got a general application for the whole of the colonial and semi-colonial world, for the ex-colonies of Africa, Asia, and Latin America. Same thing applies. And if you look at the history of the last 100 years, in Asia, Latin America, and Africa, nowhere has the bourgeoisie been able to solve the problems of society. Nowhere. And everywhere the bourgeoisie is tied to the strings of monopoly capitalism in the West and imperialism. They can't do this. And therefore, despite the victory of formal independence, like in Africa, Zimbabwe, even South Africa, you can't say that any of the real problems have been solved. You know, it's a mess. The Middle East is a case in point. Swimming with oil. The Middle East should, actually, there shouldn't be separate countries in the Middle East. I mean, you could argue that there's one Arabic nation, and it's true that there are other layers and other nationalities like the Berbers and so on and so forth. The Berbers, I suppose the Copts, the Armenians and so on, that's true. The Kurds, that's true. But nevertheless, there's one Arab people with a common language, common history, common religion, if you like, from the Euphrates to the Atlantic Ocean. Just imagine if you had one Arabic socialist republic with all the colossal mineral resources, the oil and so on and so forth. And yet look at the mess that exists everywhere. Everywhere you look, it's a disgusting, appalling mess. Even South America, by the way, where there's been a certain development, but nevertheless. South America, you know, if it could have been united, as Simón Bolívar wanted to be united, that was his program. Couldn't realize it on a capitalist basis. I mean, it would be a paradise on earth. Instead of that, look at the mess that exists everywhere, from Mexico to Tierra del Fuego. It's a mess. The terrible suffering of the masses. Now, you see, only socialism can solve this problem. The bourgeoisie can't, the national bourgeoisie everywhere plays a counter-revolutionary role. Now, the Russian Revolution, that's clear. And what Trotsky put forward as a perspective in 1905 was precisely what happened in 1917. Incidentally, as you will see from later discussions, the Bolshevik Party paid the price for the mistake. It was a mistake. Trotsky was right about that. This formula of the democratic dictatorship of the proletarian peasantry played a counter-revolutionary role in 1917. The old Bolsheviks, Kamenev and Stalin in particular, others also, clung to this. They repeated it like a pad. They didn't understand Lenin's method, only the words that he said. You know, they just repeated it mindlessly like parrots. And in 1917, they actually were prepared to support the bourgeois provisional government. Kamenev and Stalin were even in favor of unity with the Mensheviks, which Lenin was fundamentally opposed to. Lenin had to go back to Russia and sort them out. It took quite a struggle. There's a sharp internal difference on this question. And ultimately, the position that Lenin, the conclusion that Lenin came to was the very same position that Trotsky held since 1905. That's why they were able to unite very easily. And Trotsky became Lenin's main point of support from that moment onwards. Now, I've run out of time. It's a huge subject. And there's a lot more to be said. But I have to say this. I repeat, and I underline this point. The theory of the permanent revolution was brilliantly proven in Russia in 1917. It's actually what occurred. But in a negative sense, you see the opposite. Ever since the defeat of Leninism in Russia, the rise of Stalinism, Stalin always had this monstrous position, Menshevik position actually, of the two stages. You understand what I mean by two stages? That was what the Mensheviks put forward. The Mensheviks said the following. Well, Russia's a backward country. The task is for the bourgeoisie to take power. The workers must not take power under any circumstances. There must be His Majesty's loyal opposition, you know. And then the bourgeoisie will develop a nice capitalist system in Russia. They'll develop industry, they'll develop a modernized nation. And in maybe in 100 years' time, you could perhaps talk about socialism in Russia. So socialism was postponed to a dim and distant future. Some stupid reactionary bourgeois historians today repeat that nonsense. Oh, the Russian Revolution was a disaster. If only Lenin would have left them alone and the provisional government, and they could have had a nice democratic system. Really? Now, you've got to be particularly thick, particularly stupid, to accept that nonsense. If the Bolsheviks had not taken power in October Revolution, the perspective would have been what? Not a nice democratic bourgeois republic, oh no. The real perspective would have been the victory of Russian fascism, which, by the way, would have made German and Italian fascism look like a Vickers Tea Party by comparison. That was what was being prepared. The Russian bourgeoisie could not and would not carry out the necessary reforms. And the only force that would have taken power would have not been the nice liberal bourgeois, but General Kornilov and the other gangsters that emerged subsequently. Now, that was the permanent revolution in 1917. But subsequently, you see, the Stalinists revived this discredited Menshevik theory, the two-stage theory. Actually, many of the Stalinist theoreticians were former Mensheviks. That's an actual fact. So they were just putting forward the same idea as always, an idea which Lenin always combated. Now see the results. In China, the application of the two-stage theory, that the workers must not take power, that it must be the bourgeoisie, the liberal bourgeoisie, Chiang Kai-shek in that particular case, led to the complete destruction and massacre, the bloody massacre of the Chinese workers in 1927. Complete disaster. In more recent times, in Indonesia, where, by the way, they were Maoists, same thing, Stalinists, the leaders of the Indonesian Communist Party, in 1965, if my memory serves me correctly, they had the same position, two-stage theory, supported Sukarno, so-called liberal democratic dictator he was anyway. Okay, what was the result? The biggest massacre of communists in history. I think nobody knows how many, maybe 3 million, I don't know how many, at least a million. At least a million communists, men, women and children, were slaughtered in Indonesia. The Indonesian working class has never really recovered from that. And that was the direct result of this monstrous theory of two stages, that the workers must subordinate themselves to the so-called liberals, so-called bourgeois democrats, and other cases. Now you see this terrible disaster in Syria and in Iraq and the Middle East in general. You see, I remember, I'm old enough to remember, I remember distinctly the Syrian revolution. No, I'm telling you, was it Syria? No, it was Iraq. Iraq. 1958, I remember the name of the guy, Colonel Qasim. There was a revolution to overthrow the monarchy in Iraq. At that time, the Iraqi Communist Party was the main mass force. The Iraqi Communist Party in 1958 had a mass rally in Baghdad of 1 million people. Okay. What happened? Did they take power? No, mustn't take power. Because it's a bourgeois democratic revolution, two stages, first consolidate democracy, then sometime in the future, what's the result? The result, they paid the price in the form of Saddam Hussein, other dictators also, but Saddam Hussein. The Iraqi Communist Party was illegalized, was crushed, was murdered. And the result was Saddam Hussein and all the subsequent horrors which you see in the Sudan, which now is another scene of terrible horrors, a terrible nightmare in Sudan. In 1967, the Sudanese Communist Party had a rally of 1 million people in Khartoum. What did they say? The same nonsense. Oh, we must support, I think it was Nimeiri, wasn't it? I can't remember. To support the liberal bourgeoisie and so on. Two stages. Workers mustn't take, the Communist Party mustn't take power. They were subsequently, of course, you guessed it, illegalized, banned, crushed, massacred, wiped out. And the result is what you see. This madness, jihadism, slaughter, conflict between Shiites and Sunnis, barbarism, that's what it is. Barbarism. And the main people responsible for that, the point is never made, is precisely the Stalinists. Oh yes, the Stalin in the Arab countries, the Stalinists, the Communist parties had a huge support, which they lost, which they threw away, as a direct result of pursuing this criminal policy of the two stages, the two-stage theory, which has been a disaster every single place that they've applied it. And therefore, Comrade Chairman and comrades, our task, to go back to my opening remarks, as genuine Marxists, as genuine Bolsheviks, is to go back and study these theories. These theories are not just, as some people imagine, you know. Some people consider that theory is it's an optional extra, like the fairy on the Christmas tree. Well, no such thing. Theory is a guide to action. It's the light which illuminates the path of the workers towards the taking of power. And therefore our task is to study theory not as an academic exercise or an entertainment or something that is an optional extra, but a fundamental necessity, the only way in which you can provide the necessary leadership, which is the only guarantee for the success of the socialist revolution in Britain, in Europe, and on a world scale.